Was there a defining moment in your early life as a child or a young person that in some way became for you the epiphany or the revelation that you wanted to be a servant of the damaged and wounded and helpless human beings that ended up becoming your career trajectory?
I wish I could say that I thought about it for years and finally achieved my goal, but like so many things that happened to me in my life, I just think the Lord opened a door and shoved me through it. And sometimes I wasn't smart enough to walk through on my own, but I really got shoved. I can tell you that from the time I was 5, I wanted to be a doctor. From the time I was 6, I wanted to be a surgeon, although I didn't know what that really meant. I did follow that through, but all of the little side paths I took and the specialty I ended up in were all more things that were done for me rather than by my own intelligence seeking a way to do things that I wanted to do.
Can you give me an example of something that was done for you?
Well, I can give you a perfect example. I was finishing my residency at the hospital of the University of Pennsylvania, having been declared essential to that university during World War II. And I had a strep throat, and my colleagues put me to bed and started intravenous. I could hardly swallow. And the next morning at about 5 o'clock, the door of my room burst open, and in came a general in the Army who happened to be the man who had given me my job as a resident and as a surgical fellow at the University of Pennsylvania. And he said, "Chick, what do you want to do with your life?" And so I started off a funny throat, and I said, "Well, Dr. Abdon, I've come to love Philadelphia, the University of Pennsylvania. I'd like to stay here, and there's one weak spot in your whole program, and that's your tumor clinic. If you'll give me that, I'll make it sing for you." And he said, "How would you like to be the surgeon and chief of the Children's Hospital instead?" I said, "It's my second choice."
Really?
So those are the kinds of things that happen. And my going to Washington, I turned down the offer to be Surgeon General 3 times before my wife finally convinced me that I better do what was on the schedule for me.
Were there days that you didn't feel like thanking her for that?
No, the first 11 months, I have to tell you, were pure hell. Mm-hmm. Because I didn't have a friend in Washington, and I had all sorts of people who would spend as much money as they had to keep me from being the mm-hmm. Surgeon General, mm-hmm. because I was a threat to them, usually for the wrong reasons. I came to Washington, I'm probably getting ahead of your story, but I said at dinner tonight, I hate labels. And I came to Washington covered with labels. Mm-hmm. And every time my name was mentioned in the paper, all the labels were in quotation marks following my name. And that wasn't pleasant at all, because I wasn't any of those things. Mm-hmm. But once the confirmation process was over, those were the happiest days of my life. Mm-hmm. That was a marvelous job, and if I had the stamina to do it again, I'd like to try.
In his book, Soul Survivor, Philip Yancey has a chapter about you in it. And he talked in that chapter about how you were able to mold that office to fit your own strengths, that position as the Surgeon General. It might be helpful and beneficial for our listeners who could yet be unclear as to how exactly the Surgeon General functions, who the Surgeon General is. If you could enlighten us a little bit on that, and I'm particularly interested to hear about how you did mold the office to fit your own strengths, and especially the significance of the uniform that I know was real important to you.
Yeah. Okay. Here's the HHS, a cabinet mm-hmm. department, about 65,000 people in it, and they are, for the most part, civil servants. Mm-hmm. And they have job descriptions, and if you want them to do something, you say, "Would you please do so and so?" And they can say, "Not in my job description, I don't want to do that." And that's their job. Mm-hmm. In the middle of that great big bunch, there is a core, CORPS mm-hmm. and CORE, of commissioned officers. And when I went to Washington, there were 8,200 of them, all officers, no enlisted men and women. They are doctors and nurses and nutritionists and veterinarians and physiotherapists and sanitarians, and they are the people who work under the Uniform Code of Military Justice, and they don't say, "No, I don't want to do that." Mm-hmm. They are under the command of somebody called the Surgeon General, who says go, and they go, and they salute before they go, and they salute when they come back.
And you had to learn how to do the salute properly.
I knew the right hand was the right hand. I had that much down. But I had to learn the snap and things like that, because one of the interesting things about my being Surgeon General is, you know, the people who work in a job in the military or in the public health service, which is one of the 9 uniformed services of the United States, they work their way by very difficult tasks up to that position. And the highest position you can have in the public health service is a vice admiral, which is 3 stars. And all the people who were under me have been working at it for years and years and years, and I just came in and took the job at the top. And it's the only way to do it, really, you know, to come in at the top and not have to do all those 30 years of trial and error.
Well, you had your own trials.
But I had my trials, but that's what the public health service is. And the first thing that happened, and we'll answer your question about the uniform, Mr. Reagan knew almost as little about the public health service when he came to Washington as I did. And he inquired what it was, and he was told. And what most people don't know is we are older than the Navy. We went into business in 1798 under John Adams as the Marine Hospital Corps. And at that time, we had a huge merchant marine sailing vessels all over the world. And those men frequently got sick and many times died on their voyages because no one knew anything about nutrition. Or vitamins, they came back with scurvy or rickets or pellagra or something like that. And they had to have somebody to take care of them. And that's what John Adams created in the Marine Hospital Service. And we wore uniforms like the Merchant Marine did. And that has gone on through all these years. And we have essentially copied the uniform of the Navy, although we reserve the right to do some things that we will. Well, Mr. Reagan heard that we took care of merchant mariners. And he asked a question that you might expect from somebody other than the president. He said, why don't they have Blue Cross Blue Shield like I have? And we explained that that was a little difficult to do for people who were in Madagascar 1 year and Hawaii the next. And lo and behold, he, with poor advice from somebody, closed all the Marine hospitals. And so overnight, in the first month I was in Washington, we lost 2,200 of our doctors and nurses primarily, as well as other hospital people. And it wasn't just that we lost them, but these 8 hospitals around the country were our training centers, because the Commissioned Corps, of which I was the chief, they take care of the health of the Coast Guard, they backfill for the Navy, they take care of all federal prisoners, all Native Americans and Alaska Natives. And we do a tremendous number of things that most people don't ever think about and certainly don't know much about. Well, the morale of the 6,000 people left just plummeted. And they had very loose, non-stringent rules about the uniform. And although I was not yet confirmed as the Surgeon General, my suggestion was if they went back to wearing their uniform, they could just look around Washington and see who else was hurting the way they were. And that's why the uniform came back in my time. And I always wore the uniform at any time that I was doing something where I was the Surgeon General of the United States.
And did that have the effect you were
hoping?
It
had just the effect that I wanted. And eventually, I got control of the whole Commissioned Corps. And then I really put in some rules and regulations. And they still are in effect. And if you went to Washington today and watch the public health service, you'd see that most of them who can wear a uniform and are not working in an operating room or something like that are wearing it, and it does a tremendous amount for morale, but it also does an awful lot for the people that we serve.